All right, so welcome to tonight's lesson. So today we're revising the test paper that we had. So the first question in the test was this one here, which was very simple and straightforward. And I don't know why most people got it wrong, because this one I just repeated the same exercise which I gave you. This is the question, except that I changed the letters there. Otherwise, everything else was just the same. Anyway, so the question is, if A is equal to that, B is equal to that, C is equal to that, and the universal set X is equal to that, find each of the following sets and display it on the number line. So, okay. So here, what you just need to do is, remember what I told you, when you're dealing with sets, the best way to solve interval sets is to use the number line. So let's quickly begin to solve. So we get the first question there, which is A. So A is A union B, then in brackets, complement. So first of all, we're going to find A union B. And we know that our A is from 1 to 3. 3 is part of set A, 1 is not part of set F. Then B is from 2 to 6. And then 2 is part of set B and 6 is also part of set B. So if we're to find the union set, meaning we're combining A and B. So we're going to combine A and B. So A union B will simply just be equal to, we have 1, then we have 2, there's 3 there. Then we also have to combine, we have to combine in short A and B. So we're just going to start from 1 and then end at 6. So we're finding the union set. So the union set between A and B is simply just 1, 6. So now to find the complement of this set, so now we find A union B complement. So this one, we consider the universal set. Hence, this is going to start from 0. It's going to start from 0. At 0, it will be closed following the universal set. Then it will end at 1. At 1 here, when you look at 1, 1 is not part of A union B, meaning it's going to be part of A union B complement. Hence, we're going to close at 1. And then we say union, we start from 6. 6 is part of A union B. Hence, it's not going to be part of A union B complement. So we're going to open at 6 and then comma, we end at 10. So this is what you were supposed to do to find the first solution, A union B complement. So let us now draw the number line. So this is the number line. Then we have numbers ranging from 0 to 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So we have, okay, let me add 0 as well. So we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then we put this on the number line. So it's closed at 0. So we're going to close it at 0. It's also closed at 1. We close it at 1. We combine these two dots. And then we also open it at 6. So at 6, it will remain open. And then it will be closed at 10. Closed at 10. So this is what we are going to have. So this represents our A union B complement. So this is also A union B complement. So this is what you were supposed to do. I hope there are no questions here before I can move to the next one, which is B. Okay. So for B, you also do a similar thing. Let me just demarcate to allow those who are writing to copy. Okay, so B we have A minus B. So A minus B, we know that A minus B is just the same as A intersection B complement. So we already have A, our A is simply given to be 1, 3. And then our B complement, let's also list B complement. So B complement is just from, B complement is just from zero up to, where's B? B is here. So from zero up to two. Now two is part of set B, meaning it's not going to be part of the complement. So we're going to open at two there. And then we say union, it's going to start from six. Of course, six is part of set B, so it will not be part of the complement. And then we say comma 10 there. So 10, we close at 10, according to the universal set. So from there, we can now find the intersection between this set and that set. So the simplest way to find the intersection set is simply just by, so the simplest way to find the intersection set is simply just by drawing the number line. But if you want, you can just look at them. You just say, okay, A intersection B complement is equal to, you look at A, you also look at B. Do we have one in A? It's there, but it's not part of set A. Do we have one in B complement? Yes, we have one. So we're going to get this one, which is not part of set A, meaning it's going to be open at, it's going to be open at one, and then comma. Do we have three in this set? We don't have three. Let's move on to two. Do we have two in this set? It's there. So we have two in B complement. We also have two in set A. So we're going to write two there. But of course, two is not part of set B complement, meaning it's going, meaning we'll open it even there to show that it's not part of the intersection as well. Okay. So let me solve, or rather let me find the same solution using the number line. So we can have the number line like that. So this is the number line. And then we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So these are the numbers that we have on the number line. So let's put our sets. So the first set is from 1 to 3. First set is from 1, open at 1 and then closed at 3. Open at 1 and then closed at 3. Then the other set, which is, so this one is just set A. The other set, which is set B complement, is closed at 0, open at 2. So closed at 0, then open at 2. And then open at 6, it's open at 6, and then closed at 10. So it's closed at 10. So where are the lines? So this one is B complement. Yeah, so where, even this one is B complement. So where are these two sets, set B complement and A, are meeting? That's the intersection. So we shared this part where they are meeting. So this part is the one that represents our A intersection B complement. Hence A minus B, which is just the same as A intersection B complement, will just be equal to, so open at one, it's open at one, so open at two. So this is the solution. This is how you find the solution using the number line. And then the other thing that you can, the other thing that you are requested to do is putting your solution on the number line. So if, putting your solution on your number line, this one is quite simple and straightforward. So I'm just going to put important numbers, but you have to show them, you have to show all the numbers. For me, because of space, okay, let me just draw it down here. Okay, let me just draw it down. So here, let us put this. So we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, then we have 10 there. So from there, we can just put the set there, which is A minus B, which is from 1 to 2. So it's open at 1, it's also open at 2. So this is the solution for that question. So I don't know if there are questions, if you have questions, I don't know. But otherwise, the question was just simple and straightforward. Okay, so this is part A, then this is part B. All right, so let's quickly move on to the next question. Okay, so the next question is, if A and B are two disjoint sets, then simplify A complement union B complement. So if A and B are two disjoint sets, this means that A and B have no intersection, they are disjoint. So you have A there alone, you also have B there alone. So A and B are disjoint, meaning the intersection between these two elements, or rather A intersection B, is simply just an empty set. So they are asking us to simplify A complement union B complement. So A complement union B complement is simply just the same as A using De Morgan's rule, just the same as A intersection B complement. So when you put them in the brackets, when you factor out the complement, the sign in between there changes. So what we've discovered about these two disjoint sets is that the intersection of these two disjoint sets is an empty set. So what is the intersection there? I just put an empty set. Then we know that an empty set complement is simply just the universal set. So the answer here is universal set. All right, so let's move on to the next question. I don't know if you have any questions on this one before we proceed. Yeah, so if you don't have questions, we can move on. Okay, so we have this other question, which is prove that the root of 5 is irrational. So how do we prove this? We use the formula, rather the method that is called the contradiction method. So contradiction, we use contradiction method. Yeah, so contradiction method is the method that you use to prove for irrationality. So how do you prove for irrationality using this contradiction method? So you are going to make an assumption that, so we say assume, we're going to make an assumption that the root of 5 is a rational number. So we make an assumption that the root of 5 is a rational number. And if the root of 5 is a rational number, this means that it can be expressed in the form, so meaning root 5 can be expressed in the form A over B, and A and B should be members of what? Integers. And then apart from this, B should never be equal to 0. So what I'm writing here is exactly what you're supposed to write when you're proving for irrationality. Because right now what I'm doing, I'm trying to define what a rational number is. So root 5 should be able to be expressed in the form A over B, where A and B are members of integers, and B is not equal to 0. B must not be equal to 0. Then apart from that, A and B are supposed to be in their lowest term. This fraction A over B is supposed to be in its lowest term, which means that they are co-prime factors. So A and B are co-prime factors. Or if you don't understand what a co-prime factor mean, or if you can't remember this, you just say A and B, the fraction A and B, say A over B is in its lowest term. So what this means is that there shouldn't be any number that should go into A or B. That's what it means. All right, so from there, we can now take this part. We can now take the root of 5 is equal to A over B. So we simplify this by squaring both sides. So we square both sides. This side, we're going to remain with 5, and then the other side, we're going to get A squared over B squared. So you cross multiply, when you cross multiply there, you're going to have 5b squared is equal to a squared. So what this means, it means that 5 is a factor. I took time to explain this, so I'm sure you understand when I say 5 is a factor of a squared. So this also means that 5 is also a factor of A. So when 5 is a factor of A, simply means that when we divide A by 5, we are supposed to get a certain number which we don't know, which is just K. We're going to call it K. So when you cross multiply here, you are going to have A is equal to 5K. So now after doing this, you also have to make sure that you replace where there's A in this expression. When there's A in this expression, you put 5K. So we're going to copy the whole expression, which is 5B squared is equal to, while there's A here, we'll put 5K, because we've said that A is equal to 5K. So we're going to put 5K and then we square this. So when you square this, you're going to have 5B squared is equal to 25K squared. When you divide by 5 on both sides, you're going to get, you're going to get your solution to be B squared is equal to 5K squared. So this also implies that 5 is a factor. So 5 is a factor of, 5 is a factor of B squared, which also implies that 5 is also a factor of B. So according to what we found that 5 can go into both A and B. But remember what we said. We said A and B are co-prime factors, meaning there shouldn't be any number that should go into A and B. So according to what we found here, it's like the two statements are contradicting each other. We said for this root 5 to qualify to be a rational number, it shouldn't have any number that should go into A and B. So we conclude by saying A and B are divisible, by 5. A and B are divisible by 5. This contradicts with the fact that A and B are supposed to be what? Co-prime factors. Hence, the root of 5 is not a rational number, meaning it's what? Meaning root 5 is irrational. So the conclusion is also one of the important things when you're proving for irrationality. So if you have questions before we can move on to the next question, please ask. If you have questions, ask please before we can move on. Okay, so let's move on to the next question. So I don't know.
Sorry, sir, excuse me.
Okay.
I was just trying to join when you're explaining this same question.
Okay.
Because I had logged in using a phone. So please kindly go back on this one.
Pardon?
Kindly go back on this question.
All right, let me just explain it. Because there's a recorded session. I'm recording, so meaning you can find time to just go through the session. It's recorded. So let me just explain it first.
All right.
So the first thing that you have to do is you make an assumption that the root of 5 is a rational number. So we're using contradiction method, by the way. So the word itself, contradiction, meaning you have to find something that is contradicting with one of the statements that you're going to make. So we make an assumption that the root of 5 is a rational number. And for this to be a rational number, it has to be able to be expressed in the form A over B, where A and B are supposed to be members of integers. So in case you are solving and you discover that A and B, A or B is not a member of an integer, then you have to conclude that this is not a rational number. It's an irrational number. And then we also said, according to the definition of rational numbers, B should never be equal to zero. Because when you put B zero there, it means that this will be undefined, meaning it's no longer a rational number. So if you are solving, you discover that B is equal to zero, make sure that you conclude just from there to say, this is not a rational number, it's an irrational number. The other thing you have to understand for root five to qualify to be an irrational number, A and B should be in their lowest terms. So A and B should be in their lowest terms, meaning they are core prime factors. So we start solving by saying the root of five is equal to A over B. We write it there. So we write it there. Let me be using red. So we write it there. And then from there, we square both sides. So when you square both sides, you are going to square both sides. Then when you square both sides, you get this expression there, and then you cross multiply there. So when you cross multiply, you're going to get this. So this implies that five is a factor of A squared, and which is also mathematically correct to say five is also a factor of A. And then since five is a factor of A, it means that when you divide A by five, you are supposed to get a certain number, which we don't know. We're going to call it k. So when you cross multiply, you're going to have a is equal to 5k. So in this expression where you have 5b squared is equal to a squared, while there is a, you replace 5k. This is what we just did here. So while there is a in this expression, we put 5k. So you square this, you get 25k squared is equal to 5b squared. When you divide everything by 5, you discover that you get b squared is equal to 5k squared. This also implies that 5 is a factor of b squared. Same applies to this statement. It looks the same. And it is also mathematically correct to say 5 is also a factor of b. So after finding that 5 can go into both a and b, you can conclude, you can just end here now and make a conclusion to say, since A and B are divisible by five, this contradicts with the statement, or rather the fact that A and B are supposed to be what? Co-prime factors. Hence, the root of five is not a rational number. Therefore, root five is an irrational number. So this is what it means. So you can just find time to watch through the video so that you can understand it even more. Let's quickly move on to rationalizing of the denominators. So rationalizing of the denominators, let me first start with the first one there. We have the root of 5 over 2 plus the root of 5. So here we multiply with the conjugate of the denominator. So the conjugate of the denominator, we simply just change the sign in between there. So this would be negative root 5. The same thing, you do it on top. You say 2 minus root 5. So when you multiply the numerators there, you have 5 times root 2, you get 2 root 5. Then root 5 times root 5, you're going to get, root 5 times negative root 5, you're going to get negative 5. How did we get negative 5? You have the root of 5 times negative the root of 5. So when you multiply two roots, this is just the same as, so we have the negative outside there. This is just the same as saying 5 times 5 there. So 5 times 5, the answer will just be negative root of 25. So the square root of 25 is simply just 5. So this is where we got this negative 5. And then down there we have the difference of two squares, this part and this part, we have a negative in between and a positive in between there. So this can be written as 2 plus root 5, then times 2 minus the root of 5. So this is the difference of two squares. And how do you deal with the difference of two squares? Let me first write the numerator there. The difference of two squares, you square the first part there, then you square it, and then minus the second part, you have the root of 5. So you also square it. This is why we're calling it the difference of two squares. So from the previous lesson that we had, you can derive this. You can remember that we learned about this on the functions, on how to factorize the difference of two squares. So you say 2 plus the root of 5, and then in brackets, and then 2 times the root of 5. Okay, so this is the difference of two squares. So we can simplify this again by saying, let us write the numerator there, minus 5, and then everything divided by 2 squared, this will give us 4, minus the root of 5 to the power 2, this squared will cancel with the square root there, we'll just remain with 5. So when you simplify this, you're going to have 2 root 5, everything divided by 4 minus 5, or rather, there's another 5 there, negative 5. 4 minus 5, we get negative 1. So this will simply just be equal to, when you divide negative 1 into 2, we get negative 2 root 5 there. Then negative 1 into negative 5, we get positive 5. So this is the answer. If you want, you can go further by saying 5 minus 2 root 5. It's still the same. So that is how simple these questions were. Let's also solve the second one. Okay. So this one is also very simple. We have 9 on top. Down there, we have the fifth root of 125 can also be written as 5 to the power 3. So we also find the special one for this expression, the denominator. So we're going to have the fifth root of something over the fifth root of something. So this thing that we're supposed to put here, this number that we're supposed to put here, it should be such that when we multiply it with this number here, it should give us 5 to the power 5. So that 5 to the power 5, I mean, that power 5 can come and cancel with this square root there. I mean, this fifth root there. Hence, for us to get that, it means that we're going to write 5 to the power 2, such that if I multiply 5 to the power 2 times 5 to the power 3, I'm going to get 5 to the power 5. So the main reason why we're doing that is that is because, let me just write it here. The main reason we're doing that, let me even use black. The main reason we're doing that is because if we get 5 to the power 5 in the brackets there, or before I explain that, let me first write the solution this side. So we have 5 to the power 2 there. And then when you multiply this times that, we're going to get the numerator there will have 9 times the fifth root of 5 squared, then everything divided by this times that will get the fifth root of 5 to the power 5, because we're multiplying what is under the root. 5 to the power 3 times 5 to the power 2, it will give us 5 to the power 5. So now, what is the solution here? What is the answer? What is the fifth root of 5 to the power 5? So fifth root of something means anything raised to power 5. So when you raise 5 to the power 5, to the power 5, it means that when you raise 5 to the power 5, to the power 1 over 5, this is just the same as multiplying this times that, 1 over 5 times 5, we write 5 to the power, 1 over 5 times 5, this is just 5 over 5, which is just the same as 5 to the power 1, which is equal to 5. So meaning this expression down, the denominator there is equivalent to 5. So we have 9 fifth root of, this is 25. Okay. Let me just go back there. Okay, let me just erase somewhere so that I write it properly. Okay, let me just do this. So we have equals, so we have 9, and then we have fifth root of 5 squared to give us 25, then everything divided by 5 what you found down here is simply just 5. This is the answer that we found, the denominator. So this is the answer, this is the final answer that you are supposed to find. Okay, so we can proceed if you have no questions here. Okay, so we have this question there. This is where I saw things that I've never seen from the time I was born. This question, almost everyone got it wrong. So I think what we are going to do is, for me to explain this question, let us end the meeting and start another meeting, because we are remaining with 7 minutes for this to end, for this meeting to end. So let me end the meeting so that it just has its own session on its own. So that if we spend maybe 15 minutes solving it, there's no problem. Okay, so let me just end this meeting so that we start another meeting for me to solve it.
So kindly go back to the previous slide.
The previous slide?
Yes.
Okay. You have a question here?
Hello, sir.
You have a question on this slide?
No, I'm comfortable. Thank you, sir. I just wanted to screenshot it.
Oh, all right. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Okay.